Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our last seminar for the season, our May seminar. So we have Dr. Toby Pinn, and those of you who have been attending for a while will recognize her. She's presented before, although this is a new subject. So Dr. Pinn is an internal medicine specialist for large animals, so not just horses, but other large animals too. And she actually did her residency in internal medicine here at Cornell before leaving to work in a couple of private practices as a specialist. And then thankfully she came back. And so now she serves both as she does some clinical work in the hospital. So if you are ever come, you might see her there if you line up with her schedule, or she spends most of her time as a veterinary support specialist with the Animal Health Diagnostic Center, which is on campus. It's in New York State. It's the main diagnostic center for a lot of veterinary diagnostics. And she basically, if you've ever worked with your vet on an interesting case, then they may have called Dr. Pinn. She helps a lot of veterinarians interpret kind of diagnostics. And maybe you've sent blood work in to Cornell. She would have maybe looked at that. And so she helps a lot of people every day. And we're very lucky to have her. One of her kind of special specialties as an internal medicine specialist is understanding problems with bugs. So a lot of insect-borne diseases, unfortunately, we're coming into the time when that's especially relevant, at least here in New York State. And so she'll give us a brush up on some things to keep track of, some maybe new things, and then just some interesting cases as well, I think. So thank you very much, Dr. Pinn. Anyone watching, you're welcome to enter any questions you have in the Q&A, and we'll keep track of those and then hopefully get to most of them by the end and answer. Dr. Pinn will help us answer those questions at the end. Thank you very much. Looking forward to it.
All right. Thanks, Lindsay. I'll go ahead and get started then. Thanks for joining tonight. The topic that I'm going to present is what's bugging our horses, and we're going to review several insect-borne diseases that occur in horses in the Northeastern United States particularly, as well as other parts of the country. So our horses live outside. It's inevitable that they are going to come in contact with a variety of bugs, but particularly the bugs that carry certain infectious diseases to our horses that I'm going to talk about today include mosquitoes, different kinds of flies, and ticks. So within those different insect categories, we have a few different diseases. So mosquitoes carry two viruses in particular that cause disease in horses: Eastern equine encephalitis virus, and sometimes we refer to that, or your veterinarian might just call it triple E, and then West Nile virus. Ticks carry two diseases that infect our horses. One is Lyme disease, whose causative agent is a bacteria called Borrelia burgdorferi, and then another disease called anaplasmosis, caused by another bacteria, Anaplasma phagocytophilum. That one's kind of a mouthful. And then the flies can carry a variety of diseases, but those that we're going to focus on today are Potomac horse fever, caused by a bacteria called Neo-Rickettsia rusticea, and then equine infectious anemia. So that's what we're going to cover in the next hour. So we'll start off with these two viruses that are carried by mosquitoes: West Nile virus and Eastern equine encephalitis virus, or triple E. These are arboviruses, and they cycle mainly between birds, which is their primary sort of reservoir host where they replicate, and then mosquitoes bite those birds that are infected. They become infected themselves, and then they carry that virus to our horses when they sort of incidentally bite our horses and can transmit the virus that way. Our horses are what we call dead end hosts, meaning our horses are not really a way that other animals become infected. They don't really develop enough virus within them to be a reservoir for this and lead to the infection of others. But when they do incidentally or accidentally become infected through a mosquito bite, they can get sick. So it just so happens that people can also become infected through a mosquito bite with these viruses. And for that reason, these viruses are called zoonotic, meaning they infect both animals and people. The horses that are most at risk for becoming this sort of incidental, accidental host and having infection are those that are unvaccinated. So thankfully, we have an effective vaccine for Triple E and West Nile, and it's the unvaccinated horses that are most at risk. There is a sort of seasonality to when veterinarians are going to be, you know, keeping this these two viruses on their radar when they see the clinical signs, and that's the mosquito season. So summer and fall, we all think we see mosquitoes, you know, kind of all summer long, but we particularly see horses presenting with these viruses in the late summer and early fall in the Northeast. Other parts of the country where mosquitoes are, you know, prevalent year round, such as the South, they might see these viruses year round. So clinical signs will develop in horses approximately 5 to 10 days after they're bitten by the infected mosquito. And the common clinical signs include fever, dullness, you know, the horse not feeling well, acting kind of punky, not wanting to eat, and then a variety of neurologic signs. So these viruses can cause deficits to cranial nerves that are responsible for sight. So we might see blindness. They can affect the spinal cord and cause incoordination or sort of difficulty walking, loss of balance. The horse could become unable to stand or have severe difficulty standing. With West Nile particularly, horses will get some little muscle tremors. Our veterinarians might refer to those as muscle fasciculations. And then they, because some of the nerves affected might control swallowing or the ability to chew and move food in the mouth with the tongue, they can have difficulty eating and swallowing and sort of in general, just abnormal behavior, kind of somnolent, dull behavior, or they might be really hyper-reactive. So it can go either way. Thankfully, these two viruses can be relatively easily diagnosed by taking a blood sample. And we look for an antibody that the horse's immune system produces early in infection against these viruses. And that's called an IgM antibody. And the type of test is an ELISA. And that's, like I said, it's a simple blood sample. In some cases where we have spinal fluid or other tissues, we might also look for the DNA of the virus in those fluids or tissues, but the go-to test is a blood test, which is easy to acquire. Due to the types of clinical signs that develop in these cases, they oftentimes need a lot of supportive care. And unfortunately, while there is a great vaccine to prevent these horses from becoming infected, we don't have a magic bullet treatment if they do become infected, which makes vaccination really, really important. So if horses are having trouble standing, we might need to provide them with a sling or to keep them from hurting themselves if they're having trouble getting up and down or they become recumbent. And those cases are pretty severe cases. So lots of nursing care, anti-inflammatories. And just as a reminder, because I've mentioned vaccination as a preventative several times now, the way that vaccine works to prevent horses from becoming infected is when you vaccinate the horse, you're introducing their immune system to some portion of that virus or bacteria that you're vaccinating against. And it sort of primes the immune system to recognize that pathogen in the future by producing antibodies or sensitizing other cells in the immune system to produce antibodies if that pathogen is seen by the immune system. So usually this requires at least two initial vaccinations a couple weeks apart, and then an annual booster for most things that we vaccinate against. So vaccination works great. We recommend starting vaccination in foals around 4 to 6 months of age, and then annually from there on. And you have to remember that the vaccine is not really protecting the horse until about 2 weeks or so after it's been administered. So we really want to make sure we're getting these vaccines on board prior to the mosquito season so the horse is ready, but not too far in advance. So spring is typically a time to vaccinate in the Northeast, maybe late summer. One vaccine a year is usually what's recommended. However, if there's a high prevalence of this virus in the mosquito pools during a particular season, a veterinarian might recommend a booster, a second vaccine, sort of late summer if the horse was vaccinated in the spring, just to cover their bases. Horses don't respond to every vaccine they get, maximally. So it's just to reduce the risk and increase the chances that the horses have enough antibodies in their immune system ready to prevent them from becoming infected. So once a year vaccination in an adult horse is pretty typical. So while these two viruses cause somewhat similar clinical signs, when horses become infected, Triple E is more sinister than West Nile virus. Both of these viruses can result in death, unfortunately. Most horses infected with Triple E, however, will die within 2 to 3 days of becoming infected. And the mortality rate, or the proportion of horses that become infected that do die, is about 95%, so pretty high. Those lucky horses that might survive infection will often have remaining neurologic deficits. So we see that in up to 66% of cases that become infected. So there's a very good chance that if you become infected with Triple E, if the horse does, it may not survive. And those that survive are likely to have some residual clinical signs. So vaccination's super important. West Nile virus has a lower mortality rate of 42%. So not as many horses that become infected will die. And those horses that survive also have a lower rate of residual clinical signs of 18%. So West Nile virus is not quite as severe. We still want to vaccinate against both annually in regions that have these diseases. All right, so we're going to switch gears now, move away from those arboviruses, and start talking about another insect vector disease called Potomac horse fever. Potomac horse fever, sometimes a vet will call it PHF, is caused by a bacteria, Neo-Rickettsia rusticei. This bacteria gets into little trematodes or flatworms that live inside certain aquatic insects. And when the horse consumes either the little trematode or the aquatic insect, that's how they become infected. So the types of aquatic insects that spread Potomac horse fever are mayflies, caddisflies, damselflies, and dragonflies are among the most common. And the horse has to ingest this bacteria to become infected. So the life cycle of Potomac horse fever is often taking place in areas where there's some sort of standing water, because that's where the aquatic insects like to live and that's where the snails are. So horses that live in pastures that are near standing water, like a pond, or pastures that are particularly wet, that don't drain well, that have lots of puddles, those horses are at higher risk for coming, being exposed to Potomac horse fever for ingesting some of these infected insects. So as I said, you have this little trematode that gets into, that becomes infected with this bacteria that gets into snails, and then it sort of develops to the next stage, gets into these aquatic insects, and these aquatic insects somehow get into our horse, whether they drink water from the puddle or the insect dies and like falls into the water bucket in the stall or something along those lines. The clinical signs of Potomac horse fever develop about 14 days or roughly 2 weeks after the horse has been exposed. So they're not immediate. It takes a little bit of time for the horse to show its clinical signs. They typically have a fever, most often develop soft manure to diarrhea, quite severe diarrhea if it's not sort of caught and treated early, like sort of pipe stream, severe profuse diarrhea. They will have a decreased appetite. They can act colicky. Because of the diarrhea, they may become dehydrated. And because their GI tract is very inflamed by this bacteria, that can allow other bacteria in their gut to get into their bloodstream. That sets off a sort of inflammatory process in the horse's body that we call endotoxemia. And that process can lead to inflammation in their feet, which is called laminitis. So laminitis is a pretty severe consequence of horses with diarrhea, and Potomac horse fever is, you know, one of the things that can lead to diarrhea in horses. As a result of the diarrhea, these horses can leak protein out of their gut, which will cause the protein in their blood to get low. And when that happens, they will get some sort of fluid accumulation under the skin. We call that edema. It's not typically painful, but it looks like a swelling. They'll get it under their belly, in their sheath, and sometimes in their lower limbs. So I mentioned this sequela of the inflammation in the gut called endotoxemia, and we talked about laminitis developing. Sometimes horses with Potomac horse fever, when it's not caught early and treated quickly, will develop laminitis that is life-threatening. So this is one reason we want to have this on our radar and catch it quickly if it's occurring. For those of you that are not terribly familiar with laminitis, just wanted to go through that very quickly. So the horse's foot sort of has a zipper connecting the outer hard hoof wall to the inner bone, and that's called the lamina. And when horses become endotoxic, that lamina will kind of unzipper. And when that happens, you go from having normal alignment of the coffin bone inside the hoof connected to the capsule of the hoof. It will start to fall away. And we call that rotation. And that's very painful. The closest thing I could compare it to is if someone starts to like pull on your fingernail. And then they have to stand on that. So that's can be pretty painful for these horses. And when there's a lot of separation, we have sinking. So the bone can actually go through the sole of the horse's foot. So again, we really want to jump on these cases quickly and prevent them from developing laminitis. So thankfully, we have a good test for this disease. We look for the DNA in the horse's bloodstream or in their manure, or we can also look for rising antibodies in the horse's bloodstream. And we also have a good treatment for Potomac horse fever. Particularly, it works great in cases that are quickly identified. It's called oxytetracycline antibiotic. It's given intravenously, usually by a veterinarian, in the vein for several days. And then we need a lot of supportive care. So we need to prevent them from becoming dehydrated from their diarrhea. So we give them IV fluids or oral fluids are kind of encouraged. We will try to minimize their endotoxemia to prevent laminitis. So we will use a common anti-inflammatory in horses called Banamine. And then lots of supportive care to keep them comfortable and also to try to prevent that laminitis. So icing the hooves is something we'll often do. There is an effective treatment, and we do have a vaccine that is not quite as effective as the vaccines that I already mentioned for Tripoli and West Nile. The Potomac horse fever vaccine is better used to reduce the severity of clinical signs. So it may not prevent infection, but it may reduce the severity of clinical signs. And in some horses, it may prevent infection. But we know that vaccinated horses do get Potomac horse fever. But like I said, anecdotally, veterinarians that use this vaccine a lot do feel like it reduces the severity of clinical signs. Some other things we can do besides vaccinating to reduce our horses' risk of getting Potomac horse fever is to reduce their exposure to standing water, you know, keep them away from ponds, and reduce the standing water in their pasture by using good drainage whenever possible. And then turn the barn lights off at night so that you don't have a lot of insects collecting around the lights and then kind of falling into water buckets. This is a map of New York State and looking back over several years to show kind of where the cases of Potomac are happening in our state. You can see they're fairly well distributed throughout the state. And there's a region in sort of the northern portion of the state where it looks like no cases are occurring, but that's Adirondack State Park kind of area. And there's just not a lot of horses that live in the super remote portions of that park. These are just the horses that are tested, of course, where we have results to relay to you. Certainly there are many other horses becoming infected that don't have diagnostics performed. All right, now we're gonna move on to another category of insect-borne disease. We'll talk about tick-borne diseases next. There are two I mentioned, Anaplasma phagocytophilum and Lyme disease. And these are both vectored by the black-legged tick or Ixodes scapularis. And you can see in this map the regions of the US where this tick is really prevalent, and it's probably even spread from the time this map was made. So certainly the sort of eastern United States. So we'll talk about Anaplasma first. It used to be called Ehrlichia equi. So a veterinarian might refer to it by its older name. It is, as I said, transmitted by Ixodes scapularis. And it's not only our horses that become infected with Anaplasma phagocytophilum, but our dogs. There are some reports in cats, and people are also susceptible through the bite of a tick. And we do see infections in horses year round in the Northeast. We all think that there aren't as many ticks around in the wintertime, and so maybe we wouldn't be seeing this during those winter months when they're not feeding as much, but we certainly are diagnosing it year round. And you can see in the lower left picture, that is a picture of a neutrophil, a type of white blood cell in a blood smear. And those two little blobs that the arrows are pointing to, those are the bacteria actually in the horse's blood. So you can sometimes even see this on a blood smear. So the life cycle and the way that horses become exposed to Anaplasma phagocytophilum starts when an adult tick lays its eggs, and those eggs develop into a young larval stage tick. That larvae is going to take a few different blood meals and molt a few times before it becomes an adult. So each time the tick molts, it takes a meal of blood from a host, and that is an opportunity for that tick to become infected with Anaplasma phagocytophilum from another host mammal. Mice are a common one. And at the nymph stage, that tick is able to transmit Anaplasma to us, our dogs, our horses, but also it could pick up the bacteria from one of these hosts. And at any rate, there are multiple opportunities when the tick is feeding for it to become infected or transmit Anaplasma phagocytophilum to our horses. The clinical signs occur about 14 days after infection. And just like the other diseases I've talked about today, we see fever, dull attitude, decreased appetite. But Anaplasma causes some unique clinical signs. I mentioned with Potomac horse fever that you can see some lower limb swelling or swelling like fluid accumulation under the belly and in the sheath. That can also occur with Anaplasma, but it's a different process. With Potomac horse fever, I mentioned it's because the horses are leaking protein from their gut. In this case, it's actually inflammation of the wall of small blood vessels in the horse's skin. that then sort of leak fluid. And that's why we get this fluid accumulation under the skin. And that's called vasculitis. So anaplasma causes vasculitis. Also, we'll have some breakdown of red blood cells, which will lead to a jaundice or sort of yellowish tinge to the horse's gums. And sometimes the whites around the eyes are another area, or the conjunctiva around the eyes is another area where you can see this jaundice yellow color. So mucous membranes. Occasionally we'll see neurologic signs with anaplasmosis. And we also see a low platelet count, which is something that prevents horses from bruising. And when that happens, we will start to see some bruising under the gums, and sometimes like inside the vulva. So you can see some bruising on the gums. So in the upper left, you can see a horse with that lower limb swelling. And then next to that, a picture of a horse's sheath that is swollen. So again, we have good diagnostic tools, thankfully, to make a diagnosis here. One thing that a veterinarian can do in their clinic is make a blood smear and look at it under the microscope if they have one, and look for these little blobs, morula we call them, of the bacteria inside the white blood cells on the blood smear. If the vet doesn't see them, it doesn't mean they're not there. They just may not be in that sample, or they may be there in such low numbers that it's hard to find. So a blood smear might be made, but if they're not seen, it doesn't rule it out. So then the vet might recommend sending a blood sample out for PCR, which looks for the DNA of the organism in that blood sample. And ideally, we want to collect this blood sample before the horses had any treatment, since actually treatment is so effective. If we collect the sample after treatment's been started, we might not find the organism there at that point. And then finally, we can also look for antibodies in the horse's blood that are developing over time in response to being exposed. So treatment is often recommended. However, horses will clear this bacteria on their own many times without treatment. The reason that we encourage treatment is, you know, we don't want our horses to be sick for any longer than they have to, and we want to reduce the possibility that they might develop complications of being sick. So many of you horse owners know that when our horses aren't drinking well, they're predisposed to impaction colic, or kind of dry manure that gets kind of stuck in their GI tract and can make them painful. So that's one reason, amongst others, to jump on treatment and not just let the horse kind of get through it. So the antibiotic of choice is similar, the same as what we use to treat Potomac horse fever. It's the tetracycline class. And we might give it intravenously to start with and then transition to the oral form, or your veterinarian might start the oral form right away. It's case dependent. We recommend treating for at least 5 to 10 days, because anecdotally, we believe that when horses aren't treated for a long enough course, this bacteria might not be fully eliminated, and it can kind of smolder and cause infection a few weeks later if it's not thoroughly treated. So 5 to 10 day course of treatment is recommended. And then other supportive care to manage their fever. We often use Banamine. And again, like I said, keep these horses hydrated if they're not feeling great and they're not drinking well. Here's just some data from the Cornell Animal Health Diagnostic Center. And I mentioned that we often think that we don't see a lot of ticks in the winter, so maybe we don't see these diseases year round. But here you can see that while the case numbers are lower in December and January, in this particular year, 2018 through 2019 fall, we were seeing some cases in the wintertime. All right, next tick-borne disease, and one that is a little bit controversial, but I'll try to break it down and sort of give you the facts. So Lyme disease, which is caused by a spirochete type of bacteria called Borrelia burgdorferi. Borrelia is sort of endemically infecting tick populations in the Northeast and other parts of the US. And so therefore we expect a lot of horses to be exposed to this. Doesn't mean they're all infected or have disease, but a lot of horses are exposed. So there are a few recognized and well-described clinical syndromes associated with Borrelia burgdorferi infection in horses or Lyme disease. One is inflammation in the eye called uveitis. Some vets might refer to this as moon blindness. Another is a neurologic condition caused by Lyme disease, which we refer to as neuroborreliosis. The third is sort of swellings at the site of the tick bite that look like small masses under the skin. That condition is called pseudolymphoma. And some of you might recognize that word lymphoma. It's a type of cancer. We're saying pseudo. This is not cancer. It might look like cancer, but it's not. It's actually just a reaction to the tick bite locally where the tick bit the horse. So pseudolymphoma. And then there's this fourth category, which is the category that's tough, but probably the one that comes up the most. And that's the horses that have some non-specific clinical signs like lameness, stiffness, maybe an attitude change, like they were formerly really easygoing and now they're super irritable. They might develop skin sensitivity where they previously, you know, couldn't have cared less where they were groomed, now they don't like it. They could get joint swelling. So these are other conditions that we think are a manifestation of Lyme disease in horses, but they're certain that it's tougher to prove that these are being caused by Lyme disease. And I'll get into that more. So as I mentioned, the number of horses exposed in our region, the Northeast, is quite high. So we expect a lot of horses to have antibodies produced in response to this pathogen in their bloodstream. The life cycle is similar to anaplasmosis in that, you know, the tick goes through its various molts and life stages, takes a blood meal as it's molting, becomes infected with the organism and also passes it on to other hosts. The white-footed mouse is one of the hosts that we, you know, worry about and want to minimize to prevent our horses from sort of being in an area with a lot of ticks that are infected with Lyme. So if we can minimize the white-tailed mouse population, we might also be able to minimize the proportion of ticks that are infected in an area. And then deer, of course, are another major host, harder to manage that population. As I mentioned with anaplasmosis, it's not just our horses, of course, that get Lyme, it's our dogs, and of course, we're susceptible too. As ticks are going through these life cycles and looking for hosts, they do this kind of interesting behavior, which someone named questing, which I think is kind of a funny name, but the ticks will hang out in brushy areas or tall grasses and sort of reach out, waiting for their next host to come by so they can grab on. So that's called questing. So the Borrelia burgdorferi organism is smarter than your average bacteria, and one of the reasons that it's tough to diagnose and tough to treat. So typically transmission occurs within about 24 hours of the attachment of a tick. They have these outer surface proteins that they use to hide from their host's immune system. So the best I can compare that to is like they have different costumes that they can put on that disguise them from the host's immune system, and they can change those based on how long they've been in the host. That kind of keeps the host's immune system on its toes and makes it harder for it to kill this bacteria. And then again, another quality of Borrelia that makes it tough to find and tough to treat is that it persists in what we call a biofilm that's attached to tissue surfaces. So it's not floating free in joints or in the blood, it's kind of in the lining and harder to get at. So I've said this a few times now, but I'm gonna say it again. Clinically normal horses in endemic areas will have Lyme titers. They will have antibodies against Lyme in their blood. And a positive titer is evidence of current or past infection, but it doesn't predict clinical disease necessarily. It's not so straightforward. And what we oftentimes need to do is rule out other causes of the clinical signs we're seeing. in order to make a diagnosis of Lyme. And therefore, it becomes a diagnosis of exclusion. That means that we've reached this diagnosis after ruling out other things that can cause the clinical signs we're seeing. So it is a diagnostic challenge and a challenge for your veterinarian, so be patient. So we do look for the antibodies in the blood. I've talked about that a lot. And sometimes if we're lucky, we can actually find DNA from the Borrelia bacteria in the horse. We might find that in spinal fluid in horses that have this neuroborreliosis condition, ocular samples in horses with uveitis, joint fluid in horses with inflammation at the joints associated with Borrelia infection, and maybe in the skin in horses that have the pseudolymphoma condition. So the test that a lot of veterinarians will use is a blood test to look for antibodies to determine, has this horse ever been exposed? As I say, most horses have. So sometimes if you run this test and it's negative, it actually allows you to kind of rule it down on your list of possibilities. This test is unique. It looks for three different antibody types, and these are sort of three of the different outer surface proteins or kind of costumes that help this bacteria hide from the host immune system. And these different outer surface proteins are present at different times during infection or maybe even under different circumstances or in types of infections. So one is called OspA. This one is present when the bacteria goes from the tick's gut into the host, into our horse. And so we see that in early infection. We might actually see it in some chronic infections. And then this antibody is also in some of the canine vaccines. And then OspC is produced about 3 to 5 weeks after the horse has been exposed to Borrelia. So that one will kind of rise early in infection, but it declines about 5 months after the horse has been infected. And then OspF, we'll see that rising about 5 to 8 weeks after infection, and that one might last months to years. So these are just antibodies that are persisting after the horse has been exposed. So it gives us a little bit of an idea of when the horse might have been infected, how long has the horse been infected for, and it might be useful if during treatment too. So we'll talk about that more. So we treat Lyme disease with the same antibiotic that we've been discussing for Potomac horse fever and Anaplasma phagocytophilum infection, so the tetracycline class. Depending on the case, the antibiotic might be given in the vein, and that's oxytetracycline, or we might give an oral course of treatment, doxycycline or minocycline. Now, minocycline has been shown to have slightly improved penetration of the joints and the central nervous system in horses. So some veterinarians will lean that way. The duration of treatment is case dependent, but often is for several weeks, at least a month usually, and oftentimes longer. And treatment success is based on resolution of clinical signs. So, you know, your veterinarian has worked your horse up, has ruled out other causes of the horse's clinical signs, has decided to treat for Lyme. And now we're looking to see if the horse's clinical signs improve with treatment. We can also repeat that antibody test, the Lyme multiplex ELISA with those outer surface proteins that I mentioned, and see if those are declining in response to treatment. So sometimes that tells us that we might be on the right track with what we're doing. Now here's kind of throw a kink in the whole thing, because these antibiotics that we're using to treat our horse also have anti-inflammatory properties. So they're actually used in people to manage arthritis in some cases. And therefore the horse is improving clinical signs, maybe because you're treating the infection, or might be because of the anti-inflammatory properties of these antibiotics. And that's a tough one to sort out. And sometimes we really don't know until we stop treatment and see how the patient does. So I wish that there was a great way to prevent our horses from becoming infected with Borrelia, but there's not a great one yet. We can try to prevent tick exposure by clearing brush from pastures and keeping horses out of really tall, grassy, brushy, wooded areas. I myself have worked on farms where some horses are pastured in a wooded, brushy area and others are in a, you know, a grass paddock. And I notice a difference in the number of ticks that are on those horses. So it really does make a difference to change their environment as far as preventing their exposure to ticks. And then of course, frequent grooming, we do the best we can to remove ticks when we find them, but we all know that ticks are small, they're hard to find, we can't get them all. There are some topical insecticides that are labeled to sort of prevent or reduce the number of ticks on horses. None of them are really foolproof, and you can certainly try those as one of the things in your toolkit. And then I mentioned reducing the habitat for tick hosts. So we talked about the white-footed mouse, particularly, that likes to live in wood piles or be around grain containers. So if you can kind of keep grain, you know, nicely sealed and not have a bunch of brushy wooded piles around your horse's pasture, that might reduce the number of mice around and therefore the number of infected ticks. So there is a canine Lyme vaccine. So there's no vaccine that's FDA approved and labeled for use in horses in the United States. That being said, some veterinarians are using the canine Lyme vaccine in horses. There is research in this subject, and horses do seem to tolerate vaccination well with the canine Lyme vaccine. The problem is that while it seems safe, horses don't produce a really robust response to these vaccines. And there are several out there, several different types. And there's been studies looking at whether one of these is better than the other, one of these vaccine brands is better than the other, or the number of doses or how it's administered. But at the end of the day, the problem that they all seem to have is that the horse will show an initial response, but those antibodies are only present for a few months and then they often wane. So in order to keep the horse potentially, to keep the antibody levels against Borrelia up in the horse's bloodstream, you have to vaccinate multiple times a year. Now there, while we know it's safe and we know that horses, well, we think it's safe, know that horses can produce antibodies in response to vaccination. There haven't been many studies looking at the efficacy of using the canine vaccine in horses as far as it preventing infection. So more work needs to be done there. Despite that, a lot of veterinarians, as I said, do offer this vaccine to their clients. And since it's not FDA approved, it means that if your horse were to have any kind of reaction, there's no like recourse with the manufacturer. So it's a somewhat like a use at your own risk. And so you just have to go into it being well educated about, you know, what happens if there's a reaction and what we know about its efficacy. So it's kind of a cost benefit comparison for each individual owner and, you know, their horse's sort of level of risk. So the final insect vectored disease that I'm going to talk about is equine infectious anemia, or EIA. This type of disease causes fever, it can cause weight loss and anemia in horses. Survivors, so horses that become infected and remain alive, will become carriers, meaning that they are reservoirs of the disease. And so if a fly bites that horse, it can then carry the disease to another horse. Equine infectious anemia is reportable in most in the United States. It's a disease that our regulatory agencies and state vets, they want to know if it's diagnosed. And for that reason, we keep pretty close track of every horse's status. So while some of you may think, I haven't heard of this before, you've probably heard of a Coggins test. And the Coggins test is screening horses, healthy horses, for equine infectious anemia. So any horse that's traveling between states, getting on a trailer to go anywhere, showing at competitions, so congregating with other horses, changing ownership, or going through any kind of sale or auction, they are supposed to have a Coggins test that's up to date and negative. And we have some official paperwork that goes along with that. Oftentimes, the horse has its picture taken nowadays so that we can uniquely identify your horse and show that your horse is negative. But some veterinarians may still be using the carbon copy forms where they're actually drawing a picture of your horse. So that can vary. But because the clinical signs of equine infectious anemia are so severe, you know, it's really highly monitored and regulated. So that was the last disease, and I'm sure you noticed the trend. Horses infected with these diseases, they are dull, they have a fever, they're not eating great, they may have some other clinical signs as well. And sometimes in order to get to the bottom of it, your veterinarian needs to do some testing, collect some samples, send them to a lab. So I strongly encourage you to know your enemy, do the diagnostics to figure out what's causing the infection. So that you know what you're dealing with. And I work in one of these places where we perform those diagnostics at the Cornell Animal Health Diagnostic Center. All right, well, that concludes my presentation. And I want to say thank you to all of you for attending and thank you to our organizers. And I'm happy to take any questions or see if there are any questions from the chat that you'd like me to answer.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pinn. Really appreciate it. Let's see. So if anyone has questions beyond what's already in there, you are welcome to type any questions into the Q&A. And so far, there was a question you really answered already, but as always, people aren't sure what to do about Lyme disease. And so they're asking, I think maybe they're wondering what's typical for a time course treatment for Lyme disease. And you mentioned at least 4 weeks typically, and often depending, maybe longer.
Right. Yeah, it can vary. And sometimes horses will, we think they might improve initially, do okay for a little while, and then things might reoccur. So that might require more testing and then additional treatment. Unfortunately, the prognosis for horses with the uveitis and neuroborreliosis forms of Lyme is not very good, but the pseudolymphoma is quite treatable. And then some of these other nonspecific manifestations of Lyme, the lameness, attitude change, et cetera, we certainly do see horses respond to treatment. Again, oftentimes we're basing that that we think the horses respond based on the fact that their clinical signs improved or that their blood work has improved. So it's not always a black and white situation.
That's for sure. Yeah. It's like the definition of a gray situation, huh?
Yeah.
Someone's wondering if we see much Venezuelan equine encephalitis in New York.
Not typically. So there are parts of the United States that see Western and parts of the U.S. that are kind of the southwestern U.S. Where you might have a crossover area, but in the United States, we're typically vaccinating against Eastern and Western equine encephalitis, but not Venezuelan.
Mm-hmm. For now anyways, right?
Right, yeah. At this time.
This is also a tricky question about Lyme. What's our understanding if we have one as a consensus on reinfection with Lyme? They're kind of wondering about, does previous infection confer protection for any length of time?
Sure. I think at this time we feel that horses can develop new infection after previous exposure. So having been exposed doesn't prevent a horse from contracting a new infection. And it's tough to differentiate new infection from recrudescence or redevelopment of a previous infection. Mm-hmm. But I would say as a sort of general consensus, I would say that we think that it's possible for horses to become reinfected.
Of course, right? Let's see. Is crazy. So I guess maybe they're looking for a little, do you have any recommendations in particular in terms of either parasiticides or sprays to use to prevent, for example, like ticks from transmitting?
Yeah, I don't have a magic bullet product to recommend. You know, there are sprays that are labeled that unless you kind of reapply them, they may not be efficacious. There are some products like Ultra Boss, and there are some other spot-ons out there that, you know, are labeled that you sort of spot them on and they are long acting, and they may last a couple weeks. And I think it really depends. I personally haven't found them to be the one thing that keeps the ticks off. And maybe, you know, you have to really combine all of the preventative practices to put yourself in good shape. So use fly spray, well, a spray on product, use or choose a long acting. And also make sure your horses are not in a woody area. Check them over for ticks frequently. But there's just not a one great product out there that I personally am aware of.
Yeah.
But if anybody knows of one, exactly, throw it in the chat because we'd all like to hear. Do. Yeah,
definitely. And another tip I always find useful is that you kind of get to know where the ticks like to hang out on your horse, like under their chin or up in their under their elbow. And so always checking those best daily if you can is always a good idea.
Yeah, that's a great point, Lindsay, is they love to be in the warm spots, the armpits, the groin area. And then of course, with the horses grazing, they like to be under the throat latch too.
Yeah, which thankfully is, you know, easy enough to check, I suppose. So this is a hard question to answer, and there's not really an answer, but they're asking if you think it's worth vaccinating. Maybe you could say how one might decide, if it's a risk-based vaccine, what are you weighing?
Yeah, so is it worth it? Well, we don't have, as we talked about, we don't have any other great options for prevention other than these topical products plus the environmental management. And if vaccination might prevent infection, which there's a chance that it reduces the risk in some horses, certainly, and it's within your budget, because it seems so far the work that's done has shown that it's fairly safe, I think it's quote unquote worth it. Mm-hmm. It's really, like I said, a cost benefit, depending on your budget, but if you can afford it, most horses tolerate it well. You can always actually do blood work to check to see if your horse has responded to the vaccine or not, by taking a sample before they're vaccinated and then taking a sample after they've received their initial series. Because if your horse doesn't have a great response to the vaccine, it's probably not worth continuing, or you might want to try a different brand, mm-hmm, of canine Lyme vaccine. Mm-hmm. Some horses respond better to one versus another. So those are all some things you can do to try to decide if it's worth it to vaccinate or to continue.
And that's a good point with the cost, because it's so much shorter lasting than some of the others that,
right,
you really have to keep doing it, don't you? Which really,
yeah, adds up. Okay. Exactly.
I don't know the answer to this. We'll see if you do. Is it true that anaplasmosis can be transmitted more quickly after a tick bite than Lyme disease? So for example, at least in people, I think you hear Lyme can take up to 24 hours to be transmitted.
You know, I'm not certain of the answer to that question. I can certainly look it up. But I would say,
I wonder if we know.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah. I haven't heard that, but we'll look into that, Lisa. there's some comments/questions about using Seresto collars. I don't know if you have any anecdotal evidence.
You know, I've maybe heard it, but I don't have any don't know. I can't like report any official data. I've heard it out there in the ether that something people are trying. You know, I always caution people a little bit about like, when you put something like that on your horse, there's always a little bit of a risk for like a contact hypersensitivity. Mm-hmm. I know it's pretty safe in dogs, but it's meant for dogs. I would always be careful using anything off label, especially if there's not a lot of like research to back it up. Certainly, ticks are a big enough problem that, if some of these things that people out there are trying are really working and safe, I think it will filter to the top and we'll all start to hear about it. So
yes, hopefully. And I think what you mentioned about the contact reactions is important to remember for actually the kind of top line administration of any of the spot ons. That can be common. So you don't want to put it on and then leave for 3 days. You want to check, maybe an hour after and then another few hours later. And sometimes even the sprays, some of the fly sprays can have reactions. So it's always good if you're using a new product of any kind to check for reactions. Let's see, coming up on time here, but let's see.
And talk to your veterinarian, of course, right? They might, have some anecdotal, I had one client who tried that, whatever. So it's always good.
Especially for this regional stuff. Yeah, exactly. This is a good question. So maybe we can finish up on this one because we're almost out of time. Are there specific things you want to mention to your veterinarian or be thinking about to decide whether or not to use certain risk-based vaccines like the ones you've talked about today? Like they're saying, what if they're prone to laminitis or maybe immunocompromised in some way?
So your question is?
Like the risk of any vaccines, or are you ever worried about using a vaccine in a particular patient?
I see. So I would say horses that have a history of reaction, of course, or actually horses with this condition we talked a little bit about called uveitis, we are more careful with vaccination. Not that we don't vaccinate them, but we might do a few things to reduce their risk of having like a uveitis flare with vaccination. That's the main one that comes to mind is horses with uveitis. Of course, making sure that, if it's a pregnant horse, that the vaccine is labeled for use in pregnant horses, things like that.
Yeah. Great tips. Agreed. And, if you are switched or are the new area and have a new veterinarian, just making sure they know of any past reactions your horse has had to vaccines is always a good call. Well, we're at the end of time. We answered almost all the questions. So thank you very much, Dr. Pinn.
It's been absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we got a bunch of messages saying thank you, and that was a great talk. So as always, we appreciate it.
Awesome.
And we will see everyone. We'll email out the recording sometime next week, probably. And then we will feel free to contact us with suggestions for our fall topics. We already got a couple in the chat and we'll look forward to seeing you in September. Thank you very much, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Bye.